Hi, I'm Leon Herszon, head of IIL Consulting, host of our Inside Stories podcast. It is my great pleasure to have today Mathieu Maggi. Bienvenue, Mathieu. I'm trying to use my French a little bit here.
Merci, Leon. Bonjour. Good afternoon and good morning for you.
Yes. Thank you so much. So as we start here, can you share a little bit more about yourself, your career, your background? Just tell us a little bit more about you.
Okay. I will try to not give too much details. So my name, as you just mentioned, is Mathieu Maggi. I'm 46 years old. I'm 50% French, 50% Italian. I'm an electronic engineer, and I'm working for a worldwide company specialized in the automotive industry since now 2009. So 15 years ago, I started this job with this company.
And you said you're half French and half Italian, so the half Italian makes you use a lot of your hands. Like, I lived in Brazil and we use the hands when we talk all the time. So
they are there. So you see, it's I try to calm them.
Yeah, very good. So thank you for sharing that. If I understand correctly, Mathieu, you manage strategic programs at a very large global manufacturing company in the automotive industry, right? Like you mentioned. Can you tell a little bit more about what you do at this company?
So at the beginning, 15 years ago, I joined this company for as a project manager, so specialized in electronic. And a program manager or project manager job is mainly to of course, to reply to customer requests. So we start from really the initial step, which is a request for quotation. We're receiving that from a customer, from different customer, from different OEM in Europe. And we built our reply with the team. And also we reply to the customer in order to propose the best technical, commercial, and of course, timing perspective offer. And as a project manager, we try to coordinate and to identify the risk and to think about the interest of the company and of the customer. So that was my first, role within this company. And of course, getting more experience years after years, white hair after white hairs. I get from, let's say, small project to bigger project and until big programs. And now, since a few months, I had the opportunity to lead a team of different project managers in order to reply, as I said, to different phases of project.
All right. Very good. So reflecting on your journey so far, right? You mentioned 15 years of career. And of course, before that, what would you consider the most significant achievement that you had that you are very proud of, you would like to share with us?
It's a good question because especially I'm an electronic engineer, so I like everything technical, okay? I like, of course, this automotive industry, but I discovered through the different, projects and, of course, the different experiences that without, a strong team, a trustful team, we cannot achieve and we cannot accomplish the, miracle. And during one program, I remember one program, I said a program because behind this program was more than seven projects. We had, double volumes at the beginning. We had many, many car lines, many, many software variants. And without a strong team, trustful, as I said, robust, we were not able to achieve what we did. And it was really a good success. We are still delivering some part of this program. So I think we started in 2013. So you see, 10 years after, we are still, delivering some part. And I'm very proud of the team, of course, and of this project, program. It was a program, really.
Excellent. So you're talking about the people side, which is very, very important on projects, right? Not only the technical side. Not related to the technical aspect or professional background, what do you like to do when you're not working? You have any hobby, anything you like to do?
Yes, of course. I like competitions. I like sports since I'm very young, so I like competitions. I'm doing badminton. I'm a badminton player, so I'm practicing this as a, let's say as a, of course every week, and also I'm part of a team, and I'm doing also championship and tournaments during the weekend. So this is kind of how to achieve some challenges alone. So I'm doing single, single match, and also with a teammate. So with
doubles.
A partner.
All right. I play tennis, not the same, but I also had the chance to play individual doubles. It's always fun to have something, right? Are you based in Paris?
I'm based in Paris, south of Paris, in the Versailles area. So it's called Yvelines, so 78 for the department in France. And yes, that's also a good, very good area with a lot of, trees, park, and of course, gymnasium, for practicing badminton.
Excellent. Yeah, I'm kind of embarrassed to say I was born in Paris, but my French is not that good. I was born in Neuilly-sur-Seine, l'Hôpital Américain, the American hospital there. But I should practice my French a little bit more. We could actually have this interview in French. It would be very funny. But so let's keep in English. Okay. So let's talk about what you guys are doing at the moment. Your company recently decided to launch, I think around a year ago, an agile transformation program. What was the reason? What type of problems were you trying to address? Once you made that decision?
Let's say a bit of background of this decision was 2 years, 3 years ago. We identified that we, of course, as I said, we were receiving requests for quotation from different OEMs. But every time we were replying in the same way. And of course, it is not a best or our best take rate. So in order to change that, we said that we need to think differently, to maybe to anticipate before receiving that, to launch some what we call now advanced development project. So it means that it's an internal project for some specific devices, for some specific product, and with that, we put ourselves in an optimum position. So we have a product already ready, tested. We can show it to the customer, and then we can discuss in a different way than just receiving, putting some presentation, PowerPoint, and try to make an offer. So with this. With this new mindset, it's a mindset, I proposed to go, not with a classical waterfall, receiving step by step. We said maybe it's an opportunity to use Agile.
All right. So can you share with our viewers here, because a lot of companies are interested to become more Agile. We are talking not only project management, but also business agility overall, right? So you already mentioned a little bit, what was your journey so far on this agile transformation? What did you start? What you have done so far? What do you think are the next steps? Let's dig a little bit deeper on the journey itself, right?
Okay, thank you for the question, Leon. It's a huge one, this question. But to be honest, at the beginning, we were humble. because we are used to deal, especially in the automotive industry, with waterfall, mean that we are receiving specification, we analyze, we reply to the specification. If we receive something new, we analyze again. So it's really step-by-step approach. And 1 year, or yes, 1 year ago, we decided to start and to think about how to gain in terms of time to market, in terms of, I like the word agility. So it's in general, not agile, but agility, flexibility, etc. So we decided to try some project, some, as I said, advanced project with this agile methodology. Smoothly, really, because as you just mentioned, in the automotive industry, it's not so easy. Everything is conducted by the customer. So the OEM, if we don't have a contract with mentioning agile, it's difficult to implement. Nevertheless, internally, we tried. We also tried to engage. I would like to mention that, to engage our stakeholders. So it's very, very, very important. So step by step, we saw that it can be, let's say, a bit fluctuating, more or less, good at the beginning, a bit down, a bit up. And yes, we made this smooth, I want to say, transformation, a deployment, I can say like that, deployment. And now we are in a phase that we would like, of course, to deploy more with, first, internally, different departments, and secondly, with the customer. But that's a big step. And maybe, yes, it's we need to include some legal aspect in that field.
All right. So you mentioned that you started with, I understand, with one department or one area. So the decision was to go and do a pilot, see how it works, and then start spreading out. So you're telling me that right now, next steps is to start implementing that same approach to other departments, other business units, and things like that.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly. Exactly. Let's say we were, as I said, we were humble. We start with one pilot in one department. Now in this department, every new project, as I said, advanced project, so internal project, we use this methodology. So Agile, Scrum, it's kind of hybrid because we have to think for our interest. But definitely this department, it's under this mindset, this framework of Agile and Scrum.
Very good. The next question about the key success factors. Based on your experience so far, you mentioned stakeholders, right? Mm-hmm. The importance to engage with the stakeholders to have a successful Agile transformation. What else you consider key success factors for our viewers here trying to think, okay, I want to go to an Agile transformation. What are the key elements?
At the beginning, I said we need to be humble. So, I think we need to start with kind of assessment, you know, maturity assessment. I mean that we need to because we have, of course, we are a worldwide company. We have IT department. Everybody says that Agile is linked to software and to IT. But if in order to spread and to deploy, we have really to assess what is the knowledge, what is, let's say, our will, how fast we would like to move. Because if it's, let's say, 5 years, let's say, transformation versus 1 year transformation, it's not the same, of course, path, and of course, not the same effort. And so I said maturity assessment. I said pilot. I think it's a very good exercise. A small team, really motivated with volunteers. I can say that in all teams we have people which like to talk, not only the Italian one, no, but who like to talk. We have some shy person, so we have a mix in every teams. So it's a combination, and stability means that the team from the beginning until the end, and if possible to another project, we need to keep the same. So that's for me important. And the last, the stakeholders, they need to support, they need to see the benefit to have the team. And yes, and to support the team, really.
Did you get strong executive support to this initiative? Definitely, or you had first to show the result and then get the support?
It's parallel activity. So because in we went through this pilot one, so we jump on this with let's say a training with different how to say coaching session, and in parallel it was one of my activities to demonstrate let's say the progress, the benefits regarding time to market, also regarding the flexibility, and one but last but not least, it's about this mindset of result oriented. This is something that can, let's say, people can be afraid a bit with Agile because it's different than the methodology which is result task oriented, you know, step by step. Agile is more about the result. So of course we have experts in the team. Of course it's, let's say, normal that this expert is taking this activity. But it can be done normally by, let's say, by the team. And of course, when we have someone which is a bit, let's say, not doing the right speed, we can support as a team. So this mindset, this work frame for me is crucial. It's really crucial.
Do you see Agile being more used in the automotive industry? If you look to your competitors, if you look to the industry as a whole, of course, we have extreme examples like Tesla using not only Agile, but AI and other things like that. But when you see other competitors, the other companies like you, are they also using, trying to improve their business agility?
Yes, yes, yes. We can see that this is a trend in order to react quickly. You know, quickly to the different evolutions, to be able to absorb any new requirements, specification, because it can happen during a long development, for example, of 2 years, you can have, let's say, 6 months after the start, we can have maybe new regulation, because we should have identified that before, but we can have a new trend in the technology, so maybe we can integrate, and with Agile it's possible. After, as I said at the beginning, we really need to, I would say, to secure for my company and also for the customer, for the different OEMs, this framework through let's say contract. And for me, that's maybe the weakness currently.
Talking about
Tesla was a very good example, and that, of course, they are far away regarding this this approach.
Very good, very good. Talking about challenges, right? What were the main challenges that you had during this journey so far, and how did you overcome them? Because it's not everything perfect. Things might happen. You might got some resistance, or you might got some issues in the way, or maybe you had a very fantastic journey with no challenges, but maybe you have an idea what could be those challenges, so our viewers here, if they are facing something similar, they can learn what did you guys do, or what do you recommend people to do if they face challenges on their Agile transformation?
Not an easy one. Again, thank you, Leon.
Yeah, you're welcome.
yeah, that's not an easy one. No, of course, we went through some challenges. We still have some challenges in front of us. First of all, as I said, we are in an automotive industry, so we have a lot of engineers with us in the team, hardware engineers, mechanical engineers, software engineers. This approach can disturb a bit because it's really focused on result, as I said, not focused on task. It's not, let's say, of course, it's a volunteer's approach. It's really short period of time. We define the sprint, you know, period in order to go quickly to some achievement. So that can disturb. After, I discover that it's, again, it's a mindset. Some people have really this mindset. volunteers to be over what they are, let's say, they have to commit. They go over that. Some people not. So it's a mix. It's a mix. And for me, that's the first challenge we faced. The second one was, as I said, the stakeholders' engagement. At the beginning, they were really supportive. After, they were a bit, they disappeared a bit. And now we have to show them again that we have this milestone, what we call the sprint review, to demonstrate where we are, what we achieved, what we would like to do, if they can support, etc. So it's a it's a different methodology, but this is the next phase that we will start again, let's say the stakeholder engagement journey. And I can see that in the next months, I will have, of course, this support. So no doubt.
All right. Did you guys select any specific framework or approach for Agile, Scrum, Lean, Kanban? You use some discipline Agile, DevOps. What was, or you just using the general mindset? You mentioned several times mindset, which I find very, very nice. What was the basis of this Agile transformation? Did you use any framework?
So we decided to went through let's say the Scrum framework. We are using also we are not using any tool for the moment. Mm-hmm. We are using you know, the famous known and famous tool, which is Excel.
Yes.
So we are using some dashboards. We are using Kanban. It's a Kanban visual. With a visual element where we are, what we decide to, let's say, to focus, what we achieve, etc. It was our first idea in order to jump and to try, because I think it's very important to test, to fail, and to test and to do it better, etc. We went through 1, 2, 3, 4. Four projects with this way of doing. Now we start a new one with a bit better, let's say, more detail from the beginning, with user stories, with really details about value in order to calculate the velocity. So step by step, we are doing better.
All right.
No tool. It's really some Excel approach. Sharing with the team, view, you know, sharing in the, let's say, on the display for all the team.
Yeah, I'm glad to hear that you're mentioning not tools. I was talking with one of our senior Agile transformation experts, and you know him very, very well, Roy Schilling. So he was telling me that many organizations they start focusing on tools. And then process and people, and exactly the opposite. You have to focus first on people. And actually, you started mentioning about stakeholders, which is people, which makes a lot of sense. Then you define the processes, and after that, tools. So what some organizations make the mistake, okay, let's implement a tool. You don't even have a process, and people are not even ready. So I'm glad to hear. I think that might be one of the success factors for you, is not to focus on tools, but focus on people and the processes, right?
Totally agree. To focus on the people, to focus on what we know already, and to, how to say, to deploy this this mindset, because for me it's really it's a key word, this mindset, through what we call champions. I really proposed to different person in our organization that they can become a product owner, you know, or Scrum Master. For example, from my side, I decided to be certified as Scrum Master, so I did the certification, and I think it's good to have some basics and to relay this knowledge through the organization. So to have some what we can call champions everywhere in all departments.
All right. And you also mentioned about some of the benefits, right, of the results was time to market. You mentioned that a couple of times. Is there any other results that you started seeing doing your agile transformation besides time to market? What else did you see as results that you can say, hey, this works?
Except this, let's say, will to improve the time to market, and just I would like to detail a bit, because agile is not a miracle. It's not reducing the complete time to market, I can say. It's but what is really good with this methodology is that we are trying before, we are anticipating, we are doing, we are failing, but we have, let's say, initial result really at the beginning. So we are not, let's say, waiting for months to have some result. We are really doing from the beginning, we are failing, we are doing better the next time. So this approach, so what we can call time to market, or I can call also result oriented, is for, let's say, for the company, a benefit. Because we are not waiting again, sorry to insist, it's not, we are not waiting the end or the middle of a project development to get some result. And we can share this result with the customer. So the customer can give some feedbacks already. So it's it can be good, technical, commercial, many, on many areas. So it's a different approach.
All right. The name of the podcast is Inside Stories, so we love stories. Can you share one story? You don't need to tell the name of the company or anything like that. Could be success or a failure, but something that you learn in your career. I'm not only talking about the last 15 years, throughout your entire career. A story that you find that was highly important for you. Could be a success or a failure. We usually learn more about failures, right, than successes, but feel free to share any of those two.
So you decided to give me some very hard questions. Okay.
Of course.
Okay, Leon. it's not about a story. It's about meeting people. Can be weird, but I initiated my career at, 23 years old. So it's now, I'm 23 years away from that. And despite this very, let's say, technical field, I met a lot of different persons from different origin, from different countries. And based on this, various experiences, I'm still, what I want to say is that I'm still, exchanges with the person that I met maybe 20 years ago. So it's really surprising that even years and years after, I'm still discussing with the same person. So not technical element, but because we spend some time on hard time on a project, we spend some time on on validation, on testing, on finding some solution at midnight to deliver one part. So it was good and bad experiences in the full way. But I'm very, very, very glad to still to work with some of these persons.
Nice. Thank you. Thank you for sharing. Sorry about the tough question, but I know you can share this stuff. So. So looking back, Mathieu, is there anything you wish you had known before that maybe would make a difference today?
That's a good one, and I already shared that with some of my friends, is that if I would know that project management in general is a real discipline, I would like to restart with maybe this kind of school and studies during my young years, because when we as engineers we said, okay, if you would like to go to be an expert, you have to specialize you in microelectronics, in power conversions, or if you want to have maybe a more management or leadership role, then you go to project management. So I don't want to say by default we are going to project management, if you like that. But if I should, if I would know that from the beginning I can have this kind of study and experiences from the beginning, doing waterfall, PMP, etc., agile, I would like to maybe to change a bit.
All right. So we talk about the past. Let's talk about the future. We have several emergence technologies coming and trends. What do you believe have the most significant impact on your field? You talk about automotive industry. What about AI?
It's a difficult question. AI, we of course we are using partially to support to speed up a bit some collection of information, but it will not replace let's say the expertise of one person. So after, regarding software embedded, etc., maybe this is not maybe my preferred field, but maybe it should be of course taken into account. We can see also other trend is that now we would like to make more and more electrical car. We would like of course to downsize the different devices inside to make it lighter. So for example, in our field, we were looking for some GaN component, gallium nitride component instead of silicon carbide component, which are lighter. So it's to improve the efficiency of the power conversion.
All right. Are you guys using AI on a day-by-day basis? Are you using just to augment your processes, or maybe eliminate some recurrent tasks on your day by day? How is AI actually you, Mathieu? Are you using a chatbot? What are you doing with AI today?
This is exactly what you just mentioned, Leon. Is that, for example, personally, I'm using a chatbot if I have a question related to one specific topic. If, for example, I would like to perform some benchmark, questions or general question, I like the chatbot which is giving the source of the information, not just to give this brutal text. I like to receive really the detail behind. Nevertheless, it's really, I would like to say, marginal that I'm using that. It's really maybe one time, two times in a week. It's really not so much.
All right. We're approaching the end of our chat, but before I let you go, I have a couple of questions. The first one is, can you recommend one or two books that you read that you find that were important for you? It could be on any topic, but you found that it would be a good recommendation. One or two books.
Difficult. I'm not a big reader, to be honest. Long time that I did not open a book. Long time ago was the famous Lord of the Ring, because I really like the atmosphere. So nothing related to the automotive industry. Nevertheless, I like to cook, so I'm reading a lot of French chef recipe book. So like Christophe Michalak or Cyril Lignac, I'm reading a lot of book of cooking.
Very nice. What is your preferred dish to cook?
Difficult. I'm half Italian, so I should say that maybe of course lasagna.
Lasagna, yeah, that's a good one. Very good. Okay, Mathieu, final thoughts for our viewers here today. If you can summarize, what are the final message you want to leave?
So without the final message is that I was very, very, very happy to start the journey with E2L in order to get the support, the right support, to get the right, let's say, discussion and exchanges on this agile deployment. So without this support, I think the transformation would not be the same, let's say, level, at the same level right now. But what I would like to say is that without the mindset, without the people doing and people supporting, so stakeholders and the team doing, it's not possible. So you can have the best processes, of course, available. If you don't have, let's say, the mood, if you don't have this mindset, this approach, you will not succeed. Or maybe in a, let's say, a very long time. So again, people, sorry to say, it's a people first.
All right. Mathieu, thank you. Thank you so much for your time. Really appreciate that. I hope I have a chance to speak with you soon again. And merci beaucoup. À tout à l'heure.
C'était un plaisir, Léon. Merci beaucoup. Bye.
Bye-bye.